few years later, some foreigners and some Japanese folks teamed up to flip over a lorry, flip over a small truck in a street in Shibuya, and that was where it all went downhill very fast.
Wow.
Hello and welcome to the Abroad Japan podcast, probably the best way of learning about life in Japan without actually being in Japan. I'm your host, Chris Broad, and we're joined, as always, by England's top Japan enthusiast himself, Mr. Pete Donaldson. Pete, how the devil are you doing? What's going on?
I'm good, Christopher. I am watching the David Beckham documentary. That's what I did before the show. That's what I'm going to be doing. After the show, there are a few scenes where he is spending a lot of time on a Real Madrid-based Japanese tour. Which is quite fun, watching people absolutely lose their S over David Beckham arriving like some kind of beetle. It was an incredible scene, him sort of arriving at airport and stuff like that. It was really wild stuff. And it was back when, like, footballers and, you know, David Beckham and a Spice Girl, they had to use, like, public. They didn't have the private jet. So they had to spend a lot of time in quite public areas in your Heathrows, in your Hanedas of this world. So you really had to be a lot of crowd control concerns and provisions.
It was a simpler time. I've watched the Beckham. I'm not, as we all know, I don't have a great relationship with football. Mm. But I really enjoyed the David Beckham documentary on Netflix, all four episodes, because it was kind of like a nostalgic deep dive into the 90s and just the 90s in general. It took me back to the Spice Girls, Oasis. Yeah.
We were.
I mean, glory days of football.
We're not good looking now, but seeing those shots of the football fans watching in the pub, the World Cup at the Euros and stuff like that, we look horrible. We always looked up. I mean, we all look horrible now, but
I feel like David Beckham came off incredibly well in the documentary. When you
what
give
<surprise? laughs>
untrammeled, incredible access to both your life, your friends, your family, your everything, you know that it's going to be... overwhelming. In the same way, to be fair though, I mean, when I covered Hyde, the rock star, or Ken Watanabe, the movie star, I wasn't scathing in any way. I could probably have said some stuff or gone in some deeper, darker directions, but you kind of, out of respect, you don't want to, right? Because they've given you your time. And I guess it was kind of the same for David Beckham in that documentary, but it came off very well. And I came away thinking he is a lot more sort of intelligent and savvy than he lets on publicly, because he's got kind of a frail, Victoria's the one. He's kind of like that sort of chilled out, kind of frail guy with his voice. I don't know.
Yeah. He's grown into having opinions, and he's grown into someone who you would
just like
probably
you.
Say is approaching charismatic. But I would say he obviously was a footballer, pure and simple, for the longest time, and sort of fell into the world's handsomest man, world's best footballer kind of.
Pretty good looking guy.
Yeah, pretty good looking guy. But I mean, the most telling thing for me, and it sort of happens so often with high achieving individuals, is the family dynamic between them and their him and his father, him and Sir Alex Ferguson, just having this very, like, not competitive, but like you do something wrong on the football field and it's all you hear about for weeks on end. It just, I don't know, as you get older, you sort of start to think about what kind of parent you would be. And there's just something about that kind of football-y dad or football-y manager kind of dynamic that I find quite toxic. As a football fan, they've produced the best players, but it's an unethical product at best, the soccer player. But it was a really enjoyable watch, just simply because it was just funny watching a man pretend that he doesn't fold his own bloody clothes. Yeah, I'll do all this. I'll tidy all his shirts away and good colours so I can see. No, you bloody don't. I'll clean this kitchen. No, you bloody don't. There's one point where one of the blokes who were signing him for LA Galaxy out on the west coast of America. That's where LA is, if you didn't know, if you weren't in the know. But if you're not a football fan, Los Angeles is actually the west coast of America. He's signing him for that. And he's clearly been interviewed over the course of like maybe a couple of hours, this guy from LA Galaxy. I think he's the head of AEG, a big insurance agency.
Insurance company,
And he's got a cup of coffee. He's got a bottle of water and he's got a burrito to his right. He looks like he's in an airplane, like
the Holy Trio.
Lounge, and he's got a burrito.
The Holy Trinity.
The burrito never moves and he never eats any of his burrito. And all the way, it's like Chekhov's gun. I'm like, let him, that man, eat his burrito. It will have gone cold by now. So that was the most upsetting thing for me. But there's a moment where David Beckham is like, he's in his Cotswolds home. I think that's where he lives. And he's out in his shed. And he's got his little grill on the go with a load of charcoal burning away.
Yeah.
And he pops a little mushroom on the grill.
He does do that.
Yeah. And I was like, is that all he's cooking? One little mushroom. And he's like, he's going, I could stay in here all day. I'm not surprised you're cooking vegetable by vegetable, David. Absolutely incredible.
I remember that scene. Yeah. That felt very contrived.
It was all very palatial residence. Yeah.
Just this palatial residence. Like, he's out in the garden, you can't see the edge of the garden. Right. Yeah. You can see, like, the horizon.
Oh,
that's still his property.
Shelf.
And he's I've got a mushroom, innit? Victoria loves mushrooms.
Like, all of these interviews are all always, you know, obviously it's funded by the Beckhams. And they are a massive kind of industry to themselves. And, you know, there were questions about his impropriety and in his relationship and stuff. And that was brushed over in about 5 seconds. Bearing in mind, most of the show was all about his relationship with his family, with his wife, with the fans, with it. You know, this thing was there for 5 seconds, then brushed it under the carpet. So no denials or no kind of confirmations there. But it's been legaled. It's been tightly legaled.
That's right. They basically just go, terrible things in the newspaper going on. It was a difficult time. And they move on. Yeah. What should have happened is the director should have gone, did you do it though?
Did you do it? But I didn't realise the guy who's doing that is the guy who was in Succession, the man who browned up for Short Circuit, the man who... yeah. Because I grew up with Short Circuit. I'm an older man than you. And I grew up with the robot Short
Terrible
Circuit.
Film.
Johnny
Terrible
Five
film.
Is Alive. Great film. Lovely film. Brilliant film.
Terrible film. No, it's not.
I didn't realise until I was older. I think he's Phoebe's girlfriend.
But the Indian character wasn't actually Indian.
The Indian character wasn't actually Indian. I'm not saying it was a convincing accent or impression of an Indian person or wherever the hell he was supposed to be from. But I will say that maybe in the northeast of England, I didn't have access to much diversity, so I had nothing to compare it to. So that's why I thought the guy was Indian, and that's the story I'm sticking with.
We are talking about Fisher Stevens,
who plays Stevens.
He's had the most ridiculous career, right? He was in Succession as the annoying guy whose name I can't recall. What was the name of his character? Hugo.
He always had
Hugo.
A clipboard on him. Always had an iPad.
Hugo Baker, yeah. Mm. But he's also the director. So he's also directed David Beckham, the documentary.
Yeah.
Because apparently Leonardo DiCaprio convinced him. He was like, you're the man for the job, Fisher. And he was like, all right then. He doesn't even like football. And he covered
it. No, you can really tell as well. Because he's like...
But do you know what else he directed? This is bonkers. He also directed The Cove, the documentary about the dolphin killing in Japan, in Wakayama.
Nice.
So this is just the most ridiculous career. Like,
oh God,
how's he done
this?
He
didn't go undercover again, did he? Oh God. What are you doing, Fisher?
And as a bonus, he also dated Michelle Pfeiffer for 3 years. Bastard. Now I'm jealous. He's had a hell of a career.
Yeah, he's had a hell of a career. I think he's a throat cancer survivor. So
that's the not so good bit. He did have Hodgkin lymphoma. Right. So what a career. He's very good at making documentaries. I'll say it again. Don't like football, but great documentary. It made me wish that I liked football.
There's a lot more football than I expected to be in. But to be fair, a lot of the football stories, certainly the reasons why he got back on board with Project Los Angeles Galaxy. West Coast America.
Money
people.
In it.
Money, obviously, but him fixing things up with the footballer, Landon Donovan, very much had everything to do with his England career withering and everything to do with him going, I've not got that many options left. So it wasn't necessarily a summit meeting and a, you know, to put
it was also really interesting. on a sort of nature versus nurture angle, like what led to David Beckham becoming such a good footballer? Because I think you can forget he was a decent footballer because of his celebrity status. I remember when he got his bloody haircut, which was covered in the documentary, when he got his hair cut like 1997 or whatever it was, everyone in bloody England shaved their head off.
Yes.
Including all my friends as Manchester United fans. And I was like, why have you done this? Yeah. And it was because of David Beckham randomly doing it at a barber's. But like, it all comes down to his dad. His dad was the biggest football fan, weirdly, like mentally obsessed with Bobby Charlton, the footballer, and just wanted his son to play for Manchester United. And it sounded like David didn't have much of a childhood other than standing in a garden going, go on, son, hit the fucking ball. Hit it again. Oh, you can't do it. Oh, I will beat you. I'll hit it again. It was all a bit.
It's not necessarily the techniques I would employ, but then I would never have created a footballer. So there we go. I think sports people are a different breed anyway, and a lot of the more successful ones have rather odd parents.
It begs the question, if I had a child and I gave them a football and I was like, kick it, the fucking goal, and I did that every day for 10 years, would they become a David Beckham? Could I do it? Could I do it, Pete?
Could you? I don't know. I would just like to see the. How long it would take? That should be your next project to train with the J League side. Went for a coffee,
adopt
won
a
their
child.
First. My J League side, they won their first Asian Champions League match. Against, I can't remember. I think it might be an Indian team, maybe. I don't know. But either way, they won their first Champions League match, and they were in, you know, they're in J2, which is very exciting. It's the first time a J2 side has ever won a match in that particular competition. So well.
So what you're saying, I should adopt a child and mould them in my image as a footballer and make them.
a man or a woman who is obsessed. He is the perfect YouTuber. Or she is the perfect YouTuber that knows everything about artwork, about positioning, about subject matter, analytics. They've just got the biggest YouTube mind. And Ludwig and Connor and all them and Pete, all and Sharla should adopt a child and make it the perfect YouTube child. All five of you.
Couldn't we adopt one child and then each day of the week they get to spend like a Greek sort of king? Being trained by philosophers like
you're very competitive, so you'll just buy them Game Boys and more increasingly better.
I'm the
presents.
Better dad, innit? I'm your better dad. It's a Game Boy Color or whatever technology people have these days. The Switch,
it's a Game Boy Color.
Enough about this. This God molding children in our image. How sinister. Although, what a cool reason to have a kid, to make them brilliant. We got a story this week from, my God, Jay from Kilvington, who says, hello, lads. Canny Chris and Kushti Pete, my good friend Luke and I finally made the pilgrimage to Tokyo just before the pandemic, a trip I've always wanted to make in search of food, sights, nightlife and friends. We made the best of things using the godsend that is the Shinjuku subway line. We hit up a different part of Tokyo every day. I like that, like a little challenge. Oh, which station should we get off today? Oh, Roppongi, yeah. Don't get off at Roppongi. To prepare for the trip, I spent a few months learning the language. Luke, however, said he'd wing it. And wing it, he most certainly did. Now, Tokyo is great because you can really wing it. However, by day three, I'd become somewhat of the guide. Ordering drinks and meals, Luke proclaims that he can do it on his own. Now, please keep in mind, we're from Newcastle and Yorkshire, so there's a lot of accents involved. I mean, I can't understand people from Newcastle, so let alone a Japanese person. The bet was on. I said to Luke, by all means, tomorrow I won't order anything for you. It's all on you, bud. Everything was hilarious, not knowing when to thank someone, say excuse me, or the struggle of simply flailing a kimbini sandwich in the cashier's face with a fistful of notes. Come evening time, we walk into a shop bar, and with a smirk upon my face, I look at him and say, Dozo, go on, Luke, you do it. Gesturing to the bar, I sit down with my beer and wait. He wanted a whiskey and lemonade, and after 5 minutes of awkward back and forth, he returns with a shot of Jameson's and a whole lemon on a tray. I never laughed so hard in my life. We later dubbed him Harry-gato, what the fuck? Harry-gato, a cake salesman, due to his Northern English Japanese. Pete, did you run into anything like this with your accent? Yours, Jay from Kilvington, UK, with his rather confusing story about how he got drunk in a bar with some Jamesons and a lemon because his friend bungled the Japanese. Have you done this, Pete? Did you have you a Harry-gato?
I mean, I would say that most visits to any izakaya or place that serves food, I'm going to be getting something I don't want. But I think that's all about the adventure. And if you get something you don't want, you can sort of tell yourself, well, look, I've experienced something I would not normally have experienced.
Mm.
But then you are powerless to order it again if you like it. I always find.
Very true, very true. I just like the name Harry-gato. It feels like it's up there with Barry Chopsticks. You got Barry Chopsticks and Harry-gato.
It's a slow burner combo for me. I think Harry-gato would be very, you're like, oh yeah, I can get that. I would put that on my Twitter. And that's how good it is, guys. That's how fucking good it is. High bar reached.
I still think the best thing you've ever said was Harry-gato kalzaimasu at the Wagyu restaurant.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like that is a t-shirt waiting to happen. Like,
that's a Natsuki. I think I embodied everything good about Natsuki on that night.
You did.
You found an old picture, I think, of us. Was it 5 years ago in Sendai? And
yeah.
I was in the hotel room giving you the old fingers.
Yeah, there's a thing on iPhone where it's like memories from the past you should remember. Yeah. And it comes up as your wallpaper. And it was a photo of a very disgruntled looking Pete Dolson in a very messy room in
Upper
Hotel.
It was not messy, it was the tidiest room you've ever seen in your life, for crying out loud.
It looked like the roof had come down. It was messed up. I don't know what he did
it
in that room.
Messed
it's like
up,
Pete
man.
Walked into the hotel room, opened his suitcase, and just went, and just threw it all over the wall.
Threw
it was
all
mental.
Over the place, yeah. Yeah.
And like, when he opened that door, it was like looking into the gates of hell itself. But, but nevertheless, speaking of hell, Shibuya at Halloween time. And of course, Halloween is just around the corner. I love Halloween now. I used to be sort of ambivalent towards Halloween, but they embrace it in Japan, I feel, a lot more proactively than we do in the UK. Maybe because Halloween's a bigger deal in America and they've sort of nicked it as they have done with Christmas here. And Christmas decorations are already going up. But Halloween is not without its downsides in Japan. Famously, Shibuya is hell on earth. Because all of Japan seems to descend on Shibuya. And for the longest time, Pete Donaldson was amongst them. But Pete, tell us why we shouldn't be going to Shibuya this Halloween. Why it should be avoided.
Oh, Shibuya Roko. I bought a witch from Aldi last night. After seeing years of intoxicated revelers flooding the streets on Halloween, Shibuya's mayor has had enough. This year, he is determined to keep things civil in the popular Tokyo nightlife district. He is concerned about safety and crowd control. Obviously, we had those fucking terrible scenes from was it Itaewon in Itaewon's at the airport? No, Incheon is the airport.
South Korea.
Itaewon in South Korea last Halloween, where
that
tiny
really
little road where there's some nightlife district of kind of Itaewon in Seoul. Loads of people going down and just so many children.
Dozens
and
killed, right? Yeah, it was
and young people lost their lives.
Alleyway,
I mean, just knowing how small that alleyway is and being going there a couple of times, it really is tiny, isn't it? So they're just trying to basically see off something like that or see off basically an increasing level of litter and just antisocial behaviour generally. There are concerns that the crowd could reach 60,000 or more if current trends continue. They are helping the police with kind of crowd control measures. They're going to be suspending alcohol sales in the area. Patrolling will increase and drinking outdoors in public spaces will be prohibited from 6 p.m. to 5 a.m. between October 27th and the 31st. Obviously, the biggest thing is people in costumes drinking in the street, which is obviously something, you know, that I've indulged in. I'm sure you have as well, Chris, in the places up and down.
I've never drank in the street. Disgraceful.
Well, the thing that I know, last time I was there a few weeks ago, I forgot that
I drank everything.
I forgot that a lot of the 7-Elevens and stuff where younger people stand and drink and congregate, basically. Mm-hmm. They play like a very high-pitched sound so that old people can't hear it. And I'm just able to hear it. My partner, who's just a couple of years older than me, she couldn't hear it, but I could hear it. And I was like, "Bloody, what's that bloody noise?" And I forgot it was... They play like a high pitched tone to stop young people congregating. So
I
maybe
thought it was for insects. I thought it stopped insects, but I think that would also make sense.
It's only in doorways where people would possibly congregate. Just keeping people out of the doorways effectively. So
if I carry one of those on my person, could I like deafen people around me and sort of create like a bubble of space? People,
yeah, you get rid of me, but like. Like no, you wouldn't get rid of me. You get rid of Connor.
Oh, well, that sounds good.
You get rid
good.
Of young people, but you don't even hang out with cool old men.
Oh dear. I mean, the whole Shibuya thing, it's crazy. Like I went to Shibuya Halloween once or twice, and it wasn't fun. The good thing is the costumes are incredible. Nobody does cosplay better than Japan, and people really go the extra distance to do these incredible costumes. Yeah. And it was kind of fun wandering around Shibuya, taking in the costumes and drinking Strong Zero, admittedly. But then I remember nearly getting crushed in just a sea of people near Shibuya crossing. And then a few years later, some foreigners and some Japanese folks teamed up to flip over a lorry, flip over a small truck in a street in Shibuya, and that was where it all went downhill very fast. In the years after that, it was just sort of don't drink in Shibuya. People still did it anyway. Then COVID happened, and then it didn't really happen at all. And I think last year, Halloween was sort of resumed once again, but in a very toned-down fashion. And
you've really got to find a way of kind of like, I think you've got to go somewhere. Like I've always had... Tokyo Decadence, I think it's called, party
Tokyo
like Shinjuku sort of thing. Tokyo Decadence. And it's always in like a kind of Spanish restaurant, massive Spanish restaurant in Shinjuku. It floats around and stuff. I think they do a Tokyo Decadence show every month, actually. But it's like a big Halloween party that my mate introduced me to. And that's a really good place to go because it's big, spacious, everyone dresses up and it's a real event sort of thing. But I would say... fine, have a drink on the street for a bit, but you've got to go somewhere. You can't just like it's cheaper obviously to hang out on the streets and stuff and just hang out and just dick about, but like I always like to sort of be somewhere and have like an idea where I'm going. Otherwise you just stroll around Yoyogi Park dressed like one of the blokes from Yakuza, which I've done before.
I mean, last year we had the Abroad in Japan Halloween party. We had like 200-300 people turn up, and that was a lot of fun actually, seeing the costumes. And I went as Candyman yet again. I went to Daiso. I spent like 3,000 yen on sweets, stuck it to myself, and then by the end of the evening all my costume had gone, all the sweets had gone, and I could be unburdened with food. It was good. I realised though, so I didn't know the venue or the people running the event, my friends who ran it, or my behalf, at my behest or whatever, they hired like a security team. And I remember looking up, at the start of the evening, before all the guests arrived, there was like five Japanese guys, and they came up to me and they were like, "Kyo, yoroshiku, onegaishimasu," like, "Thank you, Chris, today, thank you in advance of today." And I just assumed they were waiters or something. And then throughout the night, as I turned around, I realized one of them was like following me around, and I had my own private bodyguard. It was so cool. And yet, when friends were approaching me with fake guns, the bodyguard did nothing. I thought they'd step in and be like, "Yamete, no, stay away. It didn't happen. And then at one point, I sort of fell over backwards because I might have been a little bit drunk. I fell over backwards. And he didn't really help me up. He just sort of stood there being like, Daijoubu, Chris. And he made a wall around me. But he could have, like, he didn't help me up off the floor. So, yeah, it made me kind of want a bodyguard, though. Maybe want a security team. But I think that might be a little bit out of my price range.
I think it's one of those things that you pretend that you didn't know. You knew. Surely you knew. It's like those Hollywood stars that come in and the security team do, and their agents do the nasty work, and then they come in and go, "I'm so sorry. I didn't know that happened. I had no idea."
Yeah, true. I luckily didn't follow me into the toilet. He sort of... it was interesting walking around. I was testing what lengths the bodyguard would go, and it seemed toilet.
That sounds
which is worrying because that's where crime happens.
The toilet.
That's why
Will
I want the bodyguard.
Hold my hand while I defecate, please, sir.
Oh dear. Well, if you are going to Japan, though, guys, for Halloween, you're in Shibuya, October 27 to 31. Don't drink in public, or if you do, just try and leave the Shibuya area.
If you
to be honest.
if you are thinking of drinking, don't do what I do and get so drunk. Actually, you know, take sleeping pills for the flight and then end up going straight to a Halloween party, drinking and realizing that those two things don't go together, and finding yourself asleep in front of the metro in Shibuya at 3 o'clock in the morning. And there's just a trail of, when you're dressed like Edward Scissorhands, a trail of your scissors right across the Shibuya crossing and up towards your love hotel. So just kind of just enjoy yourself, but just be careful about the things you're consuming. I think it's fair to say.
Absolutely. And just learn from Pete Dawson's mistakes, for the love of God.
Correct.
Try and pick a venue, go in a bar, have fun. We'll be back in just a moment, guys, for your stories, comments, and questions in the fax machine.
Wow.
And we're back with the fax machine. What have we got this week from our listeners, Mr. Dawson? That was an unsatisfying clap.
That was an unsatisfying, yeah.
What have we got? What you got?
Hello, Capulet, Chris and Montague, Pete. This is from Tim from Utah. Coming this October, a large group of my friends are all going to Japan, and I volunteered to be a sort of guide, as they have never been before. While I've been a few times to visit extended family, I realised it was always with my family, and I've always been for along for the ride. Do you have any tips from your experience of showing friends and family around Japan? What are some things to prepare for? I have a decent itinerary planned. I just don't really know what I'm doing. Cheers from Utah, Tim. So Tim wants to be the guide, but he's just not sure that he's going to be the best guide he can be. And he needs your help, Christopher. Mm.
I mean, tips and experience from showing. You know what? My parents still haven't come to Japan. Partly because they've been busy, partly because I've been a little bit lazy. But I'm looking at getting them to come over next year, and I'm sort of thinking, what's the balance of letting them have self-discovery in Japan,
letting them loose,
like let loose like an RPG, like go and discover the land, or like guiding them around. And
most TV shows and most successful TV show projects are Jack Whitehall and his aged dad. You know, Jack Whitehall and his dad cutting around. I mean, this has to be a video, Chris. It just simply has to be. You have to let you and your dad walking around, going to a maid cafe, spiking yourself on a hedgehog in a cafe. Just going to all the cafes, basically.
Oh, God. I remember he had a meeting, actually.
He loves robots. He's a Robot Wars guy. He loves all robots. You've got to take him to the robot cafe.
It's true. I did go to the robot cafe the other day for the first time, this one where they have Pepper the robot, and it sits and talks to you.
Yeah.
And I had a conversation about how I liked Jafar from Aladdin, and I thought Jafar, the villain of Aladdin, had some great ideas that could benefit Agrabah and the economic prosperity, to which the robot said, "That's a very interesting opinion, how you've rationalized the villain as a good guy, but you should reevaluate your opinions." And I was like,
Pepper.
The robot sorted me out. It really did. But no, I had a meeting, actually. There's Jack Whitehall. He's all right. He's a good British comedian presenter, and there's Russell Howard, who's sort of less funny. And I think I had a meeting about 5 years ago with a British producer team who were scouting in Japan for a TV series, and they wanted me to be the tour guide, I think, for Russell Howard and his dad or
or
Gran. I hate these series where it's some British presenter going around with their parent going, "Oh, wasn't it funny sushi? Oh, wasn't it funny prostitute?" Like, it's like kind of like just annoying, and I didn't get the part, and I was kind of glad. Especially as the pay was rubbish. In summary, though, Tim, what are some things to prepare for? Be prepared for anything. I think you're worrying too much. I think it'll be fine. You've got an itinerary. You've got a decent itinerary planned, as you've alleged. And I think it'll be fine. I think it'll be fine, man. Just make sure you have some time for yourself, showing friends and family around. You know, have a breather. Go for a walk on your own, because when you walk on your own, you can appreciate the moment a little bit more, I find, when you've not got friends and family going, "Oh, you buy me the orange juice? Why don't you buy this? Why don't we do that?" We've got a story from Rio, and they say, "Hello, Chris, but not Pete." No Pete.
What a shame.
You've been ignored.
What a shame.
This is a rare thing. I've been binge-watching a lot of your videos lately. I'd pretty much given up on my dream of going to Japan that I had as a kid, but after seeing you, Connor, Pete and others managed to thrive there without knowing the language, it's reinvigorated me. My biggest question is, without knowing Japanese, is it extremely difficult to find out food allergy information? I imagine with technology these days, it's a lot easier. I have a soy intolerance, So unfortunately, I know a lot of food won't be great for me in Japan. Do they label things? Thank you for your help. Thank you for the hours of entertainment. Best wishes, Rio. They don't label things that well, or certainly not in English. So bear that in mind, Rio. The word for soy is tonyu in Japan. Yeah, but luckily the word for allergy is just arugi. But it's really hard to pronounce it, and I can't do it. Arugi. Oh, I can't do it. Arugi. That's it. That's the word. Pete Donaldson won't answer the question, though, because he didn't address him. Pete doesn't do anything
now.
No,
not allowed.
He just sits there angry, filled with malice.
You guys, you two finished, are you? You two finished talking about intolerances, yeah? Just...
Yeah, I mean, it's it is quite difficult yeah, from what I've seen. And also, I think it's sometimes quite hard to sort of find out what meat is in there if you go with someone who doesn't eat certain meats. I think get the information written down beforehand and maybe you can sort of ask some people who may be able to help.
Yeah, and I mean, there's lots of good resources online for folks with allergies. Just type in like... allergy, Japan, travel. And there's some really good websites detailing how to get around it. There's someone who doesn't seem to have that many allergies, although I suspect sometimes I have an allergy to wheat and I really should get that checked. I think, right. Yeah, I think it's just get on the website, have a look there. You'll be fine. Don't worry, Rio. But be careful because there is a lot of soy. I'm digging a hole now. One last question from Stephen. It says, hello, Chris and Pete. Steve from Arizona. November will be mine and my friends, Hajimete Naomihon, my first time in Japan. I've heard that restaurants in Japan often require reservations. For a party of two, how far in advance should we make a reservation? Also, we were inspired by your video on the Shinkansen Grand Class and plan on trying it. How far in advance do you need to purchase your tickets? Or is it something that can be done at the station? All the best, guys. This is my favourite podcast. Stephen from Arizona. Thank you very much, Stephen. I'd like to hear that. You can reserve restaurants in Japan and you can do it online usually 2 days before. It gets difficult on the day and a little bit tricky the day before. But as long as it's 2 days right. before, you should be good to go. And if you're going somewhere on a Friday or a Saturday, 100% reserve if you can. Yeah. As for Grand Class, you can just rock up and just get Grand Class. When I lived in Sendai, obviously I used to come to Tokyo a lot, and sometimes the trains are rammed, and you've got Standard Class, Green Class, and Grand Class. And on the rare occasion the economy was full, then I'd go to Green Class, and if Green Class is full, I'd go to Grand Class, and I'd pay all my salary for it. So it's quite expensive.
Just hide in the smoking area like me. Just jump on and
hide in the smoking.
Hide
in the baggage rack.
Sit on the loo.
Like Carlos Ghosn. Be the Carlos Ghosn. Pete Donaldson in the bag, in the back. Or just Pete Donaldson in the toilet for 3 hours.
Yeah.
but no, it's pricey though. Grand Class. I think from Sendai to Tokyo, it used to be, it was 10,000 yen. Then right. Green Class was 14,000 yen. And Grand right. Class was 18,000 yen. So basically,
is that much of a leap? Because you do get free slippers and free booze and food.
You know, you do get slippers and you do
get
food.
Slippers. Yeah.
Well, that you the get food you get in Grand hole. Class is pretty underwhelming, isn't it? You get like a little chocolate and some sloppy bento. It's kind of like it's not worth
Grand Class sloppy
extra.
Bento.
That's true. But you got to try it one time. It's an experience, and you'll pay for it. So there you go. Give it a try. Depends where you're going there as well. If you're going to Hakodate in Hokkaido, it's worth every penny. Keep the stories, questions, comments coming in, guys, to brawnjapanpodcast@gmail.com. We really should start doing this in the comments section of YouTube. It could be a great way to drive interaction. We should do that, Pete. But then
we'll
the fax machine
stick
so
in
iconic.
The comments. Stick in the comments down here. Like and subscribe. Yeah, look at me, I'm a YouTuber. Yeah.
We'll pick out one question. We'll pick out two questions from the email address and one from YouTube comments going forward. How's that sound? Is that good?
Yeah.
Balance.
Let's do that.
Balance it out.
We're not
there
doing
you
it.
Go.
I'm not doing anything. I'm lifting a finger.
We're not doing it. We've
the
hired
arrives,
someone
I
who's...
I just do it. I read it out and I go, yeah, good. Right, brilliant. See you later.
We've hired someone whose only job it is to go through and pick out one comment a week. But do that. Comment away, guys. But above all, have a bloody good week. And we'll see you right back here to do it all over again on the Abroad in Japan podcast. Bye for now. Have a good one.